Dear Enrico Fermi, the answer is simple. The stars are too far away. As far as we know, we have always been alone. No one has ever called us. No one has ever come to visit our planet. Yet, our galaxy is full of stars, each with its planetary system. Surely, billions of celestial bodies suitable to host elementary life forms, thousands of sentient beings wandering around, and perhaps dozens of civilizations that have pushed or are trying to push themselves into space. But if that is the case, why didn't they come? Why didn't they call us? Where is everyone? The Italian physicist Enrico Fermi was the first to ask this question. In 1950, and since then, scientists have proposed a great number of solutions to the paradox that bears his name. One of the best known came from Sagan himself, who said in an article in 1981 that we just had to be patient. No one has visited us because they are all too far away. Because a species intelligent enough to invent interstellar journeys evolves, it takes time and more time for that species to spread in so many worlds. Some say that species with good technological abilities, when they emerge, then self-destruct quickly. Others suggest that aliens may have visited us in the past, or that they are avoiding us on purpose. Perhaps the most pessimistic response is contained in an article in 1975, in which astrophysicist Michael Hart declared that the only plausible reason why no wave of colonization has reached us is that there is no one out there. The question of how easily and quickly the galaxy can be colonized has played a central role in attempts to solve the Fermi paradox. It has been calculated by the Italian physicist himself and then by others that a single space species could populate the galaxy in a few million years. And if we have no evidence of this, according to Hart, it simply means that such civilizations do not exist. In the article, There Is No Fermi Paradox, physicist Robert Freitas did not hesitate to define Fermi and Hart's reasoning as a real nonsense and to compare their logic to that which supports such a discourse. Lemmings, small hamster-like rodents, reproduce rapidly at a rate of about 3 litters per year and up to 8 pups per litter. It has thus been calculated that in very few years, the total mass of lemmings should equal the mass of the entire Earth's biosphere. The Earth should then be covered by it. But most of us don't even notice their existence. Have you ever seen a lemming? Reasoning along these lines would lead us to say that lemmings do not exist. In other words, to a completely absurd conclusion. In short, many different ideas, but the most reasonable solution to the Fermi paradox is in front of our eyes, even if sometimes we pretend not to see it. The average distance between the single stars of our galaxy is too high to allow interstellar travel. It is in fact possible that, regardless of the degree of technological development of extraterrestrial civilization, the distance barrier is not as easily overcome as some literature has led us to believe. To support this thesis, let's try to take our solar system as an example. Its escape speed, starting from Earth, is 42 kilometers per second. In other words, only a vehicle launched at this speed would be able to free itself from the gravitational attraction of the Sun and project itself into interstellar space. Well, our species has already built and launched several vehicles of this kind. Even if current technology forces us to cheat a little and take advantage of the gravitational aid offered by the planets with the so-called slingshot effect to reach the limit speed. The Voyager 1 probe, for example, launched on 5 September 1977, visited the outer planets of the solar system and then headed into space, so that currently, 11 November 2020, its distance from the Sun is 151 astronomical unit, where 1 AU is the Earth-Sun distance. Unless unlikely, it will eventually drift 1.6 light-years away from a red dwarf called Gliese 445. The only problem is that the probe will take hundreds of thousands of years to reach the encounter. Voyager 1, in fact, is moving away from the Sun at a speed of 17 kilometers per second, which may seem enormous in terms of human experience, but which in reality is only 0.00055c, where c is the speed of light, which is known to be just under 300,000 kilometers per second. This means that in all these years, the probe has only managed to get 21 light hours away from the Sun. To give an idea of the enormous difference, the nearest star to our Sun, Proxima Centauri, is 4.22 light-years away. At Voyager, if it traveled in that direction, it would take almost 77,000 years to get there. If we then think that, on average, assuming the existence of about 30 alien civilizations in our galaxy, as suggested by a recent study published in Astrophysical Journal, their average distance from each other would be at least 17,000 light-years. And here, before our eyes and before our minds, real abysses of space and time open up. The enormity of the time required to travel at subliminal speeds, therefore, leads many experts to conclude that although interstellar travel is not impossible from a theoretical point of view, it is certainly impossible from a practical one. Either one travels at great speeds, or travel times become very long and impractical for any biological form. A possible objection to this thesis is based on the work of the English physicist John Bernal, who as early as 1929 proposed the idea of the generational ship, or space ark, a large, slow, and self-sufficient vehicle that would constitute the entire world of its passengers. After leaving the planet of origin, several generations of passengers would alternate on the ship before the vehicle reached its destination. Even so, it is clear that if we want to reach the stars in a reasonable time, we must build vehicles capable of traveling at a considerable fraction of the speed of light, and certainly not at the irrelevant speed of the Voyager. And even then, travel times could be long in relation to a man's life. For example, ignoring the time needed to accelerate and decelerate at the beginning and the end of the journey, a vehicle traveling at the already enormous speed of 0.1 C would take 105 years to reach Epsilon Eridani, one of the sun-like stars closest to us, 10.5 light-years. And of course, for such enterprises we would have to leave the certainty of having already identified an Earth-like planet to land on. In the face of these rather disheartening data, some people do not fail to remember that the travel times cited refer, however, to those perceived by observers on Earth. The passengers of the spaceship would in fact measure a slightly shorter interval due to the time dilation foreseen by special relativity. Although it is legitimate to ignore the effects of time dilation on space navigators traveling at 0.1 C, since it only affects 0.5%, it is indeed true that the closer the speed approaches C, the more the effect is felt. For terrestrial observers, a vehicle bound for Epsilon Eridani with a speed of 0.999 C would reach its destination in 105 years. But for passengers, the journey would only take 171 days. If it were possible to reach speeds just under the speed of light, for the travelers, the crossing would only take a fraction of a second, and it would be possible to travel to the farthest galaxies within a human lifetime, even if this would mean losing any temporal reference with their home planet. Obviously, we are very far from having developed technologies capable of accelerating a ship at a relativistic speeds. And if that were not enough, there are problems for which it is also difficult to theorize a solution. A spaceship that was capable of reaching those speeds, to give just one example, would be bombarded by the tiny dust particles of the interstellar medium, such as to subject the structure to intensity of radiation hundreds of times greater than that produced by a nuclear reactor. However, other civilizations could be millions of years ahead of us. Is it really possible that none of them have already developed interstellar travel technology? Those who are conceptually optimistic about the existence of intelligent life in space say that the fact that aliens are not here is not proof of their non-existence, but rather that interstellar travel presents objectively insoluble problems for any level of technology, and that physics does not offer any convenient shortcuts, such as hypothetical wormholes that would put distant regions of the cosmos in direct communication. In short, even the most technologically advanced civilizations must resign themselves to colonize their own backyard. Then, there is the final consideration. The logic of colonization envisages a technological civilization inspired by a plan of action projected over millions of years to come. Can you imagine a political system that launches, not a 5-year plan, not even a 10-year plan, but millions of years to program the colonization of the galaxy? And assuming that the alleged colonizers would go to found civilizations that would lose all contact with mother civilization, and that this disconnection would be repeated with every new colonized planet, how could the idea of a common conquest be maintained over time and space? Much more likely, from jump to jump and from generation to generation, the wave would break into ever smaller rivulets, and then it would be completely extinguished. No, clearly, if they are not here physically, it is because the distances involved are too demanding, whatever the technological level of a civilization. Everything we have talked about so far, however, concerns the Fermi paradox, which is called into play when you want to stress the lack of physical encounter with an alien civilization. But very often, we also hear talk of great silence. That is, the failure to receive a signal of electromagnetic nature. And also in this case, there is no lack of reasons to justify this lack without necessarily blaming it on the non-existence of the interlocutors. There are, in fact, enormous difficulties also in trying to transmit interstellar messages. We certainly have no idea what kind of communication technology an evolved alien civilization could possess. If Guglielmo Marconi, with his primitive radio receiver, was somehow transported to the New York of our days, where it only broadcasts in FM, we would deduce that there is no transmission in progress. And in the same way, he would remain unaware of the existence of transmissions using lasers, optical fibers, or geostationary satellites. Of course, the most obvious way to send information to us at present seems to be to use electromagnetic radiation. But how can we exclude that others use gravitational waves, particle beams, or hypothetical tachyon beams instead, just to limit ourselves to future technologies based on our current knowledge? How can we pretend to imagine which communication channels are available to a technical culture that could be millions of years more advanced than ours? Maybe there are so many civilizations in space committed to communicating with each other through gravitational waves, neutrinos, and tachyons, or maybe they send signals applying techniques we don't even dream about, not because they are outside the law of physics, but because for us they are just as exotic as fiber optic communication would be for Marconi. Our inability to detect signals of this kind would explain the great silence. Then there is another problem. Not knowing in advance which star is the extraterrestrial civilization we want to contact, the safest option would be to transmit isotropically, i.e. with the same power in all directions. But for example, if we wanted to send an isotropic signal up to a distance of 100 light years, the power required by the transmitter would exceed the Earth's current total electrical capacity. Not to mention the fact that 100 light years represents little more than the immediate vicinity of our planet. And the further away we wanted to push our signal, the higher the energy requirements would become. An isotropic transmitter, therefore, is well beyond our current technological capabilities. Things would change if we knew the exact position of the star to which we wanted to send the message, in which case our own Arecibo could successfully send a signal from one end of the galaxy to the other. But the problem is that, a priori, we don't know where to point the transmitter. And even if we did, as we'll see later, another problem would arise. And a parabola like Arecibo's, one emits such a narrow beam that it is extremely unlikely that by pure chance the emitting beam would align with the large receiver in some remote point of deep space. Beyond that, the stars do not stand still. If a civilization sends a signal to the point where a star is now, by the time the light reaches that point, the star will have moved. This means that the transmitting civilization will also need accurate information about the speed at which the target stars are moving. In short, isotropic transmission, which guarantees to be heard by anyone who is listening within a certain distance, is exaggeratedly expensive, while targeted transmission is much cheaper, but extremely uncertain. Is it therefore any wonder that in the face of so many problems, it is very likely that in the galaxy, many civilizations only listen, and very few or none that transmit? Besides, who would care to send messages today and receive an answer in 30,000 years?